I'm Michael Battle. I'm an alum of this place, graduated 1989, MDiv. I currently teach at General Theological Seminary in New York and the director of the Desmond Tutu Center. So that's what I do for most of my day. Have three kids, a 23-year-old named Sage, who goes between South Africa and the U.S., a middle daughter who wants to be a farmer. She's 21, named Bliss, and my son Zion wants to be a rock star. He's a senior in high school, and then my wife, Raquel, she is from Belize, Central America. And she is building the first hospice in Belize. As we start, how we introduce ourselves to each other, I would be a hypocrite if I didn't model relationality, because that's so much about what I'm gonna present to you. And I tried my best not to do the typical American thing, you know, what do? You know, that's so bad. That's not who you are. So as we get going, I wanna set the tone with, I think, a beautiful contemplative piece that was done at Trinity Wall Street as they were trying to think through climate change, and how can we pray for enough water for people around the world? And this is led by Melanie Damore. So please let this set the tone.
My friend, Zion, lift your voice in singing, for with you has come to dwell in your midst the great and holy one of Israel. Raise your voice in song. Raise your voice in song. Raise your voice in song. Raise your voice in song.
I like to start out with that because it illustrates how the Holy Spirit works with us. The technology difficulties also illustrate what I'm about to say. But for us to truly listen, to truly comprehend God, we have to have a motivation to do that. Namely, as Melanie started out, she started out in pianissimo, very quiet. You didn't know if there was sound or not. Well, I guess you knew that there was no sound. But you had to pay attention to what was going to happen next. And to me, that's what's important when we think about deep reconciliation as Christian mysticism. If we have everything going for us, and if we are socioeconomically high on the horse, if we believe we have it all together, that context doesn't lend itself so much to wanting God and listening for deep reconciliation. And I'm not trying to say that you need to be suffering or you have to be poor. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying, that the context of your life matters in terms of actually listening to God. Also, what I'm about to say really comes from the latest book that I wrote, which was on Desmond Tutu. Desmond Tutu, a spiritual biography of South Africa's confessor. And so much of what I'm saying applies to someone like Tutu, who most people see as a political agent. They don't see him as mystical. They don't see him as spiritual. Most people see him as a political figure. But I lived with Archbishop Tutu for 2 years and was his sort of de facto chaplain for about 8 months. And I saw firsthand a mystic. I can attest to it that his life was full of deep reconciliation, because how in the world could someone like him, who did not expect to live to be 90 years old, it's kind of like Martin Luther King Jr., expecting to live to be 90 years old, how can you, in that kind of a context in which I picked up the phone, because I lived in the chaplain's quarters, to receive the public phone calls, and the calls that came through were like a horror movie. The connotation of evil, the words people said, the attacks. Someone like Desmond Tutu represents a life that's contemplative and yet full of deep reconciliation to be able to do what he did. Tutu was formed by monks and anchorites and people who themselves in the desert tradition, desert mothers and fathers who would go off and live alone, trying to hear God. Because in the desert tradition, to hear God required a context in which you could hear God. And the desert tradition, one of the sayings is that you hear from God the clearest in the desert. And the work, I think, that these people did influenced someone like Archbishop Tutu tremendously. Trevor Huddleston, you'll see there on the screen. And those two women are anchorites. And I highly recommend the taller one. I recommend the other one as well. But the taller one is a very well-known mystic. Maggie Ross is her pseudonym. Have any of you ever heard of Maggie Ross? And her real name is Martha Reeves, and she's written some very powerful works on Christian mysticism that I highly recommend to you. And then the chapel underneath is the chapel that really deeply influenced Archbishop Tutu in England from the Community of the Resurrection, the chapel of the Community of the Resurrection. So here's my game plan. I know some time has been taken away from us. This is what I'm hoping that we can do together. I want us to think about deep reconciliation in a way that perhaps many of us have not. I know I'm preaching to the choir here because hopefully you have been trained that reconciliation is not just one thing. Reconciliation is a whole process, a five-fold process that I'm going to go through in just a second. And I want us to think about how is it that we can become more illumined in our own practices of deep reconciliation. And then lastly, if we have enough time, to get into the last stage of reconciliation, and that's union. And similar to the spiritual director in the cloud of unknowing, we should not long for union, because union does not necessarily happen. It can't be forced. It can't be a forced, unearned intimacy, as the spiritual director in the cloud of unknowing gives advice and wisdom to the directee. To simply make yourself available is the best practice in that last stage of reconciliation. So here is my premise. The rite of reconciliation is the same as the mystical process. The rite of reconciliation, if you look at them side by side, you'll see a pattern, because the rite of reconciliation starts with contrition and then moves to confession, forgiveness, which many of you may disagree with, but I think God does not need you to repent, because God is love. So as soon as you become aware of God through contrition, you naturally will be confessing, and you will be more likely in the presence of God through your listening and your consciousness. And in so doing, you will be made available to forgiveness. And forgiveness is what turns us around. Forgiveness is what causes the repentance. And then the last stage of reunion, again, just like the director in the cloud of unknowing, this is not a stage we should force upon a person. It's a stage akin to Christian mysticism in which we catch glimpses of union with God, but it can't be forced. Christian mysticism's process is purgation, and then illumination, and then union. And I think it follows the same patterns of the rite of reconciliation. So that's my premise. And I don't think I'm going to have much more time to go through this deep reconciliation, only just to really get into contrition. So to follow more about the other stages, I highly recommend that you read my book or read Pseudo Dionysius. So purgation and contrition. Purgation, I think, is the same as contrition, because that first step in reconciliation is a doozy. It's akin to that Kierkegaardian leap of faith. To get someone who is caught in a solipsistic world to be contrite, especially a westernized person, to be broken, to know guilt firsthand, is very difficult in a world based on the European Enlightenment, in which the agency of knowing anything is only in the individual. To get a person to truly be contrite means they're already almost one. They're almost there anyway, if you are contrite, because contrition implies that you are aware of the other. You are aware that your actions have consequences. You are aware that you matter not just to yourself when you are contrite, but you matter to others. Purgation and contrition go hand in hand because it's difficult to be contrite. Let me explain. With Berdyaev, a Russian Orthodox theologian, who had insomnia and stayed up all night worried about hell, the concept of hell. Berdyaev thought, how could he be in heaven completely happy, without need, totally satisfied? How could he be in heaven conscious that someone is weeping, gnashing their teeth forever? How could he existentially be in heaven, aware that someone is in hell? Are you with me? Berdyaev is inviting us into what I am trying to explain as a deep reconciliation. But for many of us, we do not have insomnia over that. Many of us, especially in a westernized world, think that perhaps you're all the more happy knowing that your enemy is in hell. You're all the more joyful with the sweetness of revenge. The difficulties around contrition are so powerful because the agency of moving from an individual whose world is sovereign to an individual whose world is interdependent with others. And to me, if a person is not able to understand that interdependence with others, there is no belief in God. If the way we understand our agency as an individual without being broken, without weeping with someone who weeps, without those neural reciprocal ways in which when someone smiles, we smile. When someone yawns, hopefully you aren't yawning, you yawn as well. Without the way that God has made us in natural theology to reciprocate our identities, to imprint upon others, to know ourselves, then it's difficult for us to ever need reconciliation, because really what matters is the trinity of self, me, myself, and I as a trinity. Contrition is difficult for the church also, not just as individuals, but for the church writ large. I grew up in Raleigh, North Carolina, and the constant question for me in the church was, do I have a personal relationship with Jesus? I was never asked, do I have a communal relationship with Jesus? That was an unintelligible question. And for some reason, our speech gives us away, because underneath our speech is our belief system. And to have salvation that is solipsistic is not the salvation that God offers. God offers salvation that is always interdependent. And contrition is one of the ways in which we join that interdependence. I hold up this first step of reconciliation because it's one of the most difficult ones for us in the Western world. And I hold up someone like Tutu, who represents someone who's able to be broken, able to be contrite, not just for himself, but for a whole nation state. And what they offer, what South Africa offers and what Tutu offers in his theology, is a deep reconciliation that's not cheap grace. So many of the books that I've written, a Presbyterian publisher that I love, that I say that just so that I can bond with you all here, Westminster John Knox, constantly would always try to put reconciliation in anything I ever wrote. Because they know that's what the world needs. But also there is a danger in a publisher always trying to get reconciliation in the title, because that's what people want to hear who are in power. People who are in power want reconciliation. And so when Nelson Mandela came out of prison, 27 years, he wanted a truth commission. And when F.W. de Klerk was going out of power, guess what kind of commission he wanted? A reconciliation commission. And thanks to the wisdom, the purgation that produced such a soul like Mandela, he had the wisdom to know he needed to be a good Anglican, even though he was Methodist, and have a both and bring truth and reconciliation together. And it's through this contrition, this listening to where is the deepest reconciliation, not a cheap grace. Where is the deepest reconciliation? How can it be practiced? That South Africa embarked upon the purest truth and reconciliation practice of any other nation state. There have been other truth commissions and other nation states that said they had truth and reconciliation, but no other nation state gave amnesty to civilians. Most truth and reconciliation commissions were for the military. And so if you think about restorative justice, you are thinking about a deeper kind of reconciliation. And of course, it's not just restorative justice, it's distributive justice. It's also transformative justice. So just a clip here, just to invite you into how restorative justice is spreading around the world.
A single act of crime can affect someone long after it happens. The mind replays it endlessly, warping what really happened and consuming our thoughts. No one can undo what happened, but there is a simple process which 85% of victims of crime said helped. Restorative justice is a process through which victims can meet their offender. It allows them to ask questions, have their say, and move on with their lives. Help us spread the word about restorative justice. You never know who it may help in the future. Restorative justice works. Share this film and help us spread the word.
So you remember that I started out saying that it's difficult to have contrition. So can you imagine trying to get someone who thinks that they are simply trying to survive and that somebody has enough money already, and so I'm just going to take her purse. Trying to get someone who is justifying their actions, their thoughts, their beliefs, and they do not understand the consequences. Trying to get someone like that to be contrite. And the difficulties around trying to force contrition is that it's impossible to do. Contrition reminds me of a Far Side cartoon. You all know about Far Side? When I was growing up, it was what I would look at in the newspaper every day. So here is a Far Side cartoon with some spiders trying to catch little kids coming down the swing. If we pull this off, we'll eat like kings. You're supposed to laugh at that. You cannot expect the spider to be contrite, right? As Nietzsche would say, you can't say to an eagle, stop being an eagle. And Nietzsche's right. But we are not spiders, and we're not eagles. We're human beings, and we're people of faith who believe that we are made in the image and likeness of God. And so we have been given a gift of contrition, and we do not live simply based on our own reptilian brain and our own solipsistic world. Contrition is deep and genuine awareness of guilt, and in so doing, we're already entering God's world. And God does not want our sacrifices. God wants us to enter into God's world. God is, as we believe in our Christian revelation of Jesus incarnate, has already made God's self available. But God cannot force us to be available to God. And so as we saw in that clip, in that practice of restorative justice in the UK, whether we like it or not, we're going to be broken. And whether we like it or not in life, we're going to practice a contemplative life. But the contemplative life may be more dysfunctional. As psychotherapists would call it, it's more of a rumination, caught in a cycle of thoughts and anxieties. But we think about prayer as resistance. The contemplative life is offering us a positive approach, not a negative one. And here is the good news for us, put mystically. contrition is the awareness that we are more than animals. And to me, that's important, because if we see ourselves only as animalistic, then we are not giving ourselves that availability to be like God. Here is another impossibility when it comes to contrition. Here is someone, Scott Reuter, who goes into a church on Sunday morning. He meets an usher. The usher takes him to his seat in his pew. And then as the usher turns around, Scott Reuter takes a gun and holds it to the back of the usher's head and shoots him in the name of God, kills him in Sunday worship. Kill someone because he sees that he's doing God's will, because he's saving unborn life. The usher was OBGYN, Dr. George Tiller, who performed late-term abortions. Contrition is the step that gets us in trouble through religiosity, because not only are we having trouble being broken, but we're having trouble with what we think is right. And oftentimes we're confusing righteousness and justice with dysfunction and evil. Also, contrition shows us that the church, more and more, we're finding violence occurring in churches. And that's interesting to me, because this was in South Africa that Archbishop Tutu was called basically to help bring a sanctuary back to sanctity and to see how this church that was bombed could be restored. Churches are assigned to so many people that here is a community that is of God. And for me, contrition is very difficult for the secular world as well, because they see an aftermath of a church that oftentimes has only shown dysfunction. And in this case, this was done by Black youth who were bombing a white, historically white church in South Africa. For me, if we're going to think about contrition, we must think about it warts and all, not just theoretically, but how can we practice brokenness in a way that it can bring restoration? And the violence that you see here in this church building, when I'm teaching this rite of reconciliation, many of my students say, "Why are you showing me this? This is inappropriate." But what contrition is about is always trying to get us to be conscious of what is occurring. And that's why I started out with the only way to be conscious of what is occurring is paying attention to the context that we are in. If we're going to think about moving forward, how is it that we can create consensus around contrition, which seems so impossible to do? Fortunately, in this season of Lent, the church has set up practices, not just for individuals, but for communities to practice contrition. So the Lenten season is one way. How is it that we can practice knowing our sin and knowing where to find our cleansing? The difficulty here, though, is that even through the benign aspects of a church learning contrition, not just individuals, but a church, we find the subliminal messages that occur. Purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Just realize what the subliminal messages are as we try to practice contrition. And imagine someone of color trying to practice Lectio Divina with this passage of scripture in terms of how our sin as people throughout time has changed our language and has made us in such a way that the church is not able to really hold on to this revelation of scripture and what scripture is trying to say. Here is an example. Apartheid was a way of spirituality for those who were Afrikaners. Apartheid means to be set apart. What is another word for to be set apart? Holy. Apartheid was meant as a positive word in South Africa, as a way of showing that God's trustworthiness is given and Afrikaners are chosen to bring righteousness to Africa. So contrition is very difficult to find consensus when even in scripture and even in our theology, we cannot have agreement. And I think Archbishop Tutu is important in this endeavor as he tries to show consensus and where and how to do it. Here is a clip.
Despite all appearances to the contrary, it is a moral universe that in the end, good prevails. Segregation was a key aspect of our lives. You knew, I mean, that there were some who were in and the others were out. You had these separate exits, but then you went onto the same street and you breathe the same air, and it was crazy, but a lot of it was humiliating. You were human, but you were not quite as human as the others.
You are saying no to evil.
No.
We say yes to goodness.
Yeah.
Very many good things have happened. I mean, one is we're free. It was quite unbelievable how quickly it happened. I mean, it was, as they sometimes say, like greased lightning. I mean, one day Nelson Mandela is in jail, the next he's out. Then you have negotiations, and hey, presto. We have a democracy.
But I and the ANC are as opposed to black domination as we are to white domination.
Imagine if we had chosen the path of retribution and revenge. Our country would have been dust and ashes now. When you nurse a grudge, your blood pressure shoots up and you feel it in your tum-tum. Whereas when you forgive, your blood pressure goes down and you have a physical well-being that reflects your spiritual well-being. So that you can say, forgiving is good for your health.
So what I think is important that Tutu is teaching us is the way forward was not to create a zero-sum game with an apartheid theology. The way forward was to continue to work for consensus, agreement about God. And the way he did that was basically doing what my spiritual director, Curtis Almquist, says in one of his monastic sayings, what we see in other people, particularly in people who affront us, is ourselves. They wouldn't get to us the way they do if they didn't already have a place in us. They are the mirror. Either that, or we are being visited by someone we will become. Rather than looking upon them with distance or disdain, treat them with kindness, because they are kin to us. And this is the way Archbishop Tutu's spirituality and his deep reconciliation operated. He used humor to disarm audiences bent on running him out of the room. He was someone who held up a concept called Ubuntu, which means I am because we are. And because we are, I am. And now keep in mind, he's saying this to his enemies. He's not trying to create a zero-sum game that I'm going to take you over. Because he realizes that if he does take them over, there is just a cycle that will continue. And so for Tutu, he understood the mirroring effect. He understood how we need each other in order to be ourselves. And I think the difficulties, as I need to wrap up, and I told you I couldn't get much more past contrition, the difficulties for us in the Western world is that it's hard to be contrite when we are really living according to our own definitions of what is good for me, and that the default mode is me. And so I end with David Foster Wallace, who is this wonderful writer and thinker, who helps us to see ourselves, warts and all, in the Western world, and how hard it is for us to be contrite.
Swimming along, and they happen to meet an older fish swimming the other way, who nods at them and says, "Morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two young fish swim on for a bit, and then eventually one of them looks over at the other and goes, "What the hell is water?" The point of the fish story is merely that the most obvious, important realities are often the ones that are hardest to see and talk about. Stated as an English sentence, of course, this is just a banal platitude. But the fact is that in the day-to-day trenches of adult existence, banal platitudes can have a life or death importance. The plain fact is that you graduating seniors do not yet have any clue what day in, day out really means. There happen to be whole, large parts of adult American life that nobody talks about in commencement speeches. One such part involves boredom, routine, and petty frustration. The parents and older folks here will know all too well what I'm talking about. By way of example, let's say it's an average adult day, and you get up in the morning, go to your challenging white-collar college graduate job, and you work hard for 8 or 10 hours, and at the end of the day you're tired and somewhat stressed, and all you want is to go home and have a good supper and maybe unwind for an hour and then hit the sack early, because of course you have to get up the next day and do it all again. Then you remember there's no food at home. You haven't had time to shop this week because of your challenging job. And so now, after work, you have to get in your car and drive to the supermarket. It's the end of a work day, and the traffic is apt to be very bad. So getting to the store takes way longer than it should. And when you finally get there, the supermarket is very crowded, because of course it's the time of day when all the other people with jobs also try to squeeze in some grocery shopping. But you can't just get in and quickly out. You have to wander all over the huge, overlit store's confusing aisles to find the stuff you want. And you have to maneuver your junky cart through all these other tired, hurried people with carts, et cetera, cutting stuff out because it's a long ceremony. And eventually, you get all your supper supplies, except now it turns out there aren't enough checkout lanes open, even though it's the end of the day rush. So the checkout line is incredibly long, which is stupid and infuriating, but you can't take your frustration out on the frantic lady working the register, who is overworked at a job whose daily tedium and meaninglessness surpasses the imagination of any of us here at a prestigious college. But anyway, you finally get to the checkout line's front and you pay for your food and get told to have a nice day in a voice that is the absolute voice of death. And then you have to take your creepy, flimsy plastic bags of groceries in your cart with the one crazy wheel that pulls maddeningly to the left, all the way out through the crowded, bumpy, littery parking lot. And then you have to drive all the way home through slow, heavy, SUV-intensive rush hour traffic, etc., etc. Everyone here has done this, of course, but it hasn't yet been part of you graduates' actual life routine, day after week, after month, after year. But it will be. And many more dreary, annoying, seemingly meaningless routines besides. But that is not the point. The point is that petty, frustrating crap like this is exactly where the work of choosing is going to come in. Because the traffic jams and crowded aisles and long checkout lines give me time to think. And if I don't make a conscious decision about how to think and what to pay attention to, I'm going to be pissed and miserable every time I have to shop. Because my natural default setting is the certainty that situations like this are really all about me. About my hungriness and my fatigue and my desire to just get home. And it's going to seem, for all the world, like everybody else is just in my way. And who are all these people in my way? And look at how repulsive most of them are and how stupid and cow-like and dead-eyed and non-human they seem in the checkout line. Or at how annoying and rude it is that people are talking loudly on cell phones in the middle of the line. And look at how deeply, personally unfair this is. If I choose to think this way in the store and on the freeway, fine. Lots of us do. Except thinking this way tends to be so easy and automatic that it doesn't have to be a choice. It is my natural default setting. It's the automatic way that I experience the boring, frustrating, crowded parts of adult life when I'm operating on the automatic, unconscious belief that I am the center of the world, and that my immediate needs and feelings are what should determine the world's priorities. The thing is that, of course, there are totally different ways to think about these kinds of situations. In this traffic, all these vehicles stuck and idling in my way, it's not impossible that some of these people in SUVs have been in horrible auto accidents in the past, and now find driving so terrifying that their therapist has all but ordered them to get a huge, heavy SUV so they can feel safe enough to drive. Or I can choose to force myself to consider the likelihood that everyone else in the supermarket's checkout line is just as bored and frustrated as I am, and that some of these people probably have much harder, more tedious, or painful lives than I do. Again, please don't think I'm giving you moral advice, or that I'm saying you're supposed to think this way, or that anyone expects you to just automatically do it, because it's hard. It takes will and effort, and if you are like me, some days you won't be able to do it, or you just flat out won't want to. But most days, if you're aware enough to give yourself a choice, you can choose to look differently at this fat, dead-eyed, over-made-up lady who just screamed at her kid in the checkout line. Maybe she's not usually like this. Maybe she's been up 3 straight nights holding the hand of her husband who's dying of bone cancer. Or maybe this very lady is the low-wage clerk at the motor vehicles department who just yesterday helped your spouse resolve a horrific, infuriating red tape problem through some small act of bureaucratic kindness. Of course, none of this is likely, but it's also not impossible. It just depends what you want to consider. If you're automatically sure that you know what reality is and who and what is really important, if you want to operate on your default setting, then you, like me, probably won't consider possibilities that aren't annoying and miserable. But if you've really learned how to think, how to pay attention, then you will know you have other options. It will actually be within your power to experience a crowded, hot, slow, consumer hell-type situation as not only meaningful, but sacred, on fire with the same force that lit the stars. Love, fellowship, the mystical oneness of all things deep down. Not that that mystical stuff's necessarily true. The only thing that's capital T true is that you get to decide how you're going to try to see it. This, I submit, is the freedom of real education, of learning how to be well-adjusted. You get to consciously decide what has meaning and what doesn't. That is real freedom. That is being educated and understanding how to think. The alternative is unconsciousness, the default setting, the rat race, the constant gnawing sense of having had and lost some infinite thing. I know that this stuff probably doesn't sound fun and breezy or grandly inspirational the way a commencement speech is supposed to sound. What it is, as far as I can see, is the capital T truth with a whole lot of rhetorical niceties stripped away. You are, of course, free to think of it whatever you wish. But please don't just dismiss it as some finger-wagging Dr. Laura sermon. None of this stuff is really about morality or religion or dogma or big fancy questions of life after death. The capital T truth is about life before death. It is about the real value of a real education, which has almost nothing to do with knowledge and everything to do with simple awareness. Awareness of what is so real and essential, so hidden in plain sight all around us all the time, that we have to keep reminding ourselves over and over, this is water. This is water.